हेलो एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ अफशा, इंग्लिश लेक्चरर एट एलिजाबेथ हाई स्कूल एंड जूनियर कॉलेज. वेलकम बैक टू माय क्लास. टुडे लेट अस गो विद द 13th लेसन ऑफ आवर इंटर फर्स्ट ईयर एंड द नेम ऑफ द लेसन इज स्पोकन इंग्लिश एंड ब्रोकन इंग्लिश. आई होप बाय द नेम इटसेल्फ यू आर गेटिंग एन आइडिया रिगार्डिंग द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ द लेसन, राइट? सो दिस पीस हैव बीन रिटन बाय जॉर्ज बर्नार्ड शॉ. सो when we learn a foreign language, many of us think we should learn to speak and write it in the way its native speakers do. For example, when we learn English, we feel our aim should be to able to speak and write it like Englishmen, Americans or Australians. But do all native speakers of English speak the same way? So here what it is asking, right? When we are trying to learn any language, what we will think of it, we will think that we should learn the language, right? Or we should write or speak in the way the native speakers will do. For examples, if you are trying to learn English, then you will think that you have to learn English, right? In the way as if the Englishman will speak. But what do you think? Do all the natives speak in the same way? No, it is not the fact actually. For that matter, taking our own languages, do all Telugu speakers speak Telugu the same way? Or do all Urdu or Hindi speakers speak Urdu in the same way? No, all differ from one another, right? The way of talking of each and every individual will differ from one another. Doesn't matter, even though they are speaking the same language, but they will having own way of expressing their words. And does each one of us speak our own language the same way at all times? In all situations? No, right? So read on to find answers to these questions. So before beginning with our lesson, let us have a look on the author's introduction. As I have told you earlier, right, the author of this lesson is George Bernard Shaw. He was born in the year 1856 and he died in the year 1950. Was a great Irish playwright. He was also a powerful public speaker, essayist and critic. So he was not only a writer, but he was also a public speaker and essayist. It means that he also used to write essays and a critic. He campaigned for many causes, including the simplification of the English alphabet and spelling. His ideas are original and thought-provoking. His prominent plays include Widower's Houses. So, it was his famous writings that he wrote in the year 1892. Then, the next one is Arms and the Man. Then, one more that has been given is Saint John. Then, Pygmalion and etc. The play Pygmalion was also made into a film, My Fair Lady. So, this Pygmalion, it is a play actually, a drama that has also been made into a movie by name My Fair Lady. The play is about training a flower girl to speak English properly. In all his writings, Shaw showed an unconventional turn of mind and a distrust of accepted institutions. His writings are marked by wit and humor. Before going in deep of the lesson, let us have a look on the short description that has been given before the text. This is an extract from Spoken English and Broken English, which was in fact a speech recorded in the year 1927. Okay, so this was actually a speech that was recorded by George Bernard Shaw in the year 1927. The piece is noted for its typical Shavian wit. It discusses at length with apt examples how English is spoken in different ways by different native speakers and also with the same speaker in different contexts. The essay ends with some practical suggestions to foreign users of English. The style is simple but marked with rhetoric. This piece, this essay, right, or else we can say this speech is regarding the use of language by different speakers, right? So here the George Bernard Shaw is making the people aware that the way of speaking differs from one person to another. Doesn't matter they belong to the same place or they are the people from different places, right? And he's saying that there are different ways, right, in which the native speakers will speak a language, right? For example, an Englishman will have a different accent when compared to the foreigner, right? Foreign speaker of English language. And on the other hand, one Englishman will be having a different accent when compared to the other Englishman also. Okay, so this is all about our lesson. Now let us go in deep. I am now going to suppose that you are a foreign student of the English language and that you desire to speak it well enough to be understood when you travel in the British Commonwealth or in America or when you meet a native of those countries. So here, how he is starting his speech is, I am now going to suppose, right? I here refers to George Bernard Shaw. He is going to suppose that the persons who are sitting in front of him are the foreign students of the English language. What is the meaning of foreign students of English language? The students who are aspiring to learn English. Okay? And that you desire to speak it well enough to be understood when you travel in the British Commonwealth or in America. So, as we have discussed earlier, a person who is willing to learn a language will obviously try to speak in the way the native speakers will do, right? Or it may be that you are yourself a native, but that you speak in a provincial or Cockney dialect, right? What he is saying, or assume that you are a native only, but you don't have a correct way of speaking English. You are behaving as a Cockney dialect. It means that it's a native of East London, of which you are a little ashamed, or which perhaps prevents you from obtaining some employment, which is open to those only who speak what is called correct English. Now, whether you are a foreigner or a native, the first thing I must impress on you is that there is no such thing as ideally correct English. No two British subjects speak exactly alike. So here, George Bernard Shaw is beautifully picturizing, right? And saying that here George Bernard Shaw is effectively explaining that there is no term as a correct English. Because even two native speakers will not speak in the same way. There is no means of correct English anywhere in the world, right? English is just English. The way you speak may be different and the way I speak may be different. I am a member of a committee established by the British Broadcasting Corporation for the purpose of deciding how the utterances of speakers employed with the corporation should be pronounced in order that they should be a model of correct speech for the British Islands. So he was a member of the committee, okay, established by the British Broadcasting Corporation, and that committee was set up, right, for the purpose of deciding how the utterances means the way one speaks, right, of speakers employed by the corporation should be pronounced. So he was in the committee that was supposed to decide the way of the speakers in order that they should be a model of correct speech, right? All the members of that committee are educated persons whose speech would pass as correct and refined in any society or any employment. So not only him, but all the other members of that committee are well educated, right? And those are the persons whose speeches would be considered as the correct way of pronunciations, right? Wherever you go, in the society or in the field of employment or else in the whole country, we can say. Our chairman is the poet laureate. What is the meaning of poet laureate? Poet laureate is a person, a poet, who is appointed to write for the state occasions. Fine? Who is not only an artist whose materials are the sounds of spoken English, but a specialist in their pronunciation. Because the writers and the authors will be having a different way of expressing their words. They will not use the simple language, right? They will just use a beautiful language for expressing their views. One of our members is Sir Johnston Forbes. So he is describing about a person whose name was Sir Johnston Forbes Robertson, famous not only as an actor but for the beauty of his speech. I was selected for services on the committee because as a writer of plays, I am accustomed to superintend their rehearsals and to listen critically to the way in which they are spoken by actors who are by profession trained speakers. So here, what it is saying, he is describing a person whose name was Sir Johnston Forbes Robertson, who is not only famous as an actor but for the beauty of his speech. It means that he used to have very motivational and very beautiful speeches. I was selected. Here I refers to George Bernard Shaw again. So he was selected for the service in the committee because as a writer of plays, What was his role? He was accustomed to superintendent, right? Superintendent means to check out, right? He was the head actually to superintend their rehearsals and to listen critically. Critically in the sense, in order to decide what is correct and what is wrong to the way in which they are spoken by actors. So he was appointed, right? What was his work actually? He was appointed to check the way the actors are speaking. Being myself a public speaker of long experience, why he was appointed for such position means he was having full experience as a public speaker. That committee knows as much as anyone knows about English speech, and yet its members do not agree as to the pronunciation of some of the simplest and commonest words in the English language. The two simplest and commonest words in any language are yes and no, but no two members of the committee pronounce them exactly alike. So he is just giving of two simple words, right? That is yes and no, right? Even inside the committee, no two members will pronounce even these small words in the same way. All will be having their different way of pronunciations. I have said enough to you about the fact that no two native speakers of English speak alike. But perhaps you are clever enough to ask me whether I myself speak in the same way. I must confess at once that I do not. So what I am saying here, till now we have told that no two speakers, doesn't matter they are from the same country or from the different country, will have the same accent, right? But now what he want to say, that he is confessing that even himself will not speak in the same way every time, right? For example, just take some words which you will pronounce it in one way at one time and other way at the other time. Nobody does. I am at present speaking to the audience of many thousands of gramophonists. What is meaning of gramophonists? Persons who are listening to the gramophone records, who are using the gramophones actually. So here he is saying that, he is giving the example that I am at present speaking to the audience, right? Many thousands of gramophonists, many of whom are trying hard to follow words syllable by syllable, right? So when you become a public speaker, you have to keep in view that the audience who are sitting in front of you will have full of concentration on you. They will be listening to you word by word and syllable by syllable, right? So you have to be careful while saying any words, while uttering a single word in front of them. If I were to speak to you as carelessly as I speak to my wife at home, this record would be useless. And if I were to speak to my wife at home as carefully as I am speaking to you, she would think that I was going mad. So here what he is saying, the way how I am speaking here, the formal way of speaking that I am using here in front of you, right? If I speak in the same way with my wife, then she will think that I gone mad. And the way I use at home, if I start using it here, this speech will be of no use. It will become useless. So he means to say that the way a single person will pronounce words, the way a single person will talk will also differentiate, right? Will also differs from one situation to the another. As a public speaker, I have to take care that every word I say is heard distinctly at the far end of large halls containing thousands of people. But at home, when I have to consider only my wife sitting within 6 feet of me at breakfast, I take so little pains with my speech that very often instead of giving me the expected answer, she says, "Don't mumble and don't turn your head away when you speak. I can't hear a word you are saying." Right here what he is saying, as a public speaker, he need to speak in the way that all the thousands of people sitting in the place of audience should get the point what he want to say. He need to be very careful and audible and very clear with his utterances, right? But in the same way, when he sits at home, right, in front of his wife, just 6 feet far away from his wife, and how he speaks there, he mumbles to himself. That is not even clear to his wife, right? I can't hear a word you are saying. And she also is a little careless. Sometimes I have to say what. two or three times during our meal, and she suspects me of growing deafer and deafer, though she does not say so because as I am now over 70, it might be true. So this whole this speech was given by George Bernard Shaw when he was 70 years old. So he is sharing his personal experience when he sits in front of his wife at the dinner table, or else food, we can say, having meals. So how they will speak to one another in the way that both of them doesn't understand a single word. They mumble. They doesn't speak clearly, right? Sometimes his wife says that you are becoming deafer and deafer day by day, and he thinks that maybe she is correct because he was around 70 years old. No doubt, I ought to speak to my wife as carefully as I should speak to a queen, and she to me as carefully as she would speak to a king. We ought to, but we don't. Don't, by the way, is short for do not. So, okay. So, what here he is saying, no doubt, right? They are supposed to talk to one another as if they are the king and queen of some place, right? As if they are talking to some queen or king. But they don't. They doesn't behave very officially or very formally with one another, because that is a personal relation over there. But coming to the audience, right? When we speak to audience or someone outside our home, we have to be professional. We have to be formal. That is our responsibility. We all have company manners and home manners. So here he is describing about company manners and home manners. What does it mean? Company manners are the manners that we have to apply when we are outside our home, right? And home manners, of course, we know the meaning, that it is a way how we are supposed to be at home, how we are expected to be at home, right? If you were to call on a strange family and to listen through the keyhole, not that I would suggest for a moment that you are capable of doing such a very unladylike or ungentlemanlike thing. But still, if in your enthusiasm for studying languages, you could bring yourself to do it just for a few seconds to hear how a family speak to one another when there is nobody else listening to them. And then walk into the room and hear how. So what here he is saying, just simply, you are having two different ways of behaving. One is the company manner, other one is the home manners. And you have to differentiate between those two properly. You cannot behave in the way how you behave in the company at your home. You cannot behave formally at home. Right? You have to be respectful with other family members, but you should not be formal. But coming to the company manners, you have to be formal as well as respectful with others. Here is giving a very small example. Suppose I forgot to wind my watch and it stops. I have to ask somebody to tell me the time, right? If your watch stops for some time, what you need to do? You are supposed to ask time to someone else, right? If I ask a stranger, I say, what o'clock is it? In a very formal way, right? The stranger hears every syllable distinctly, each and every syllable, each and every pronunciation distinctly. But if I ask my wife, all she hears is clocks. That is good enough for her. But it would not be good enough for you. So I am speaking to you now much more carefully than I speak to her. But please don't tell her. So you, what he is saying? The way I ask the time to a stranger and to my wife will differ definitely, right? To a stranger, I need to pronounce in a very proper way. I have to ask word by word, what o'clock is it? But coming to wife, if she just hear clocks also, then it will be enough for her, right? I am now going to address myself especially to my foreign hearers. I have to give them another warning of quite a different kind. If you are learning English because you intend to travel in England and wish to be understood there, do not try to speak English perfectly, because if you do, no one will understand you. I have already explained that though there is no such thing as perfectly correct English, there is presentable English which we call good English. So here what he is saying, as we have discussed earlier, there is no correct English, right? But there is a good English. What is the meaning of good English? That will be easily understandable by others, right? So here he is saying that, he is addressing to his foreign learners, foreign language learners, and he is saying that if you are willing to learn English because you want to move to England, then don't try to pronounce the words in the way the Englishman will do. But try to speak good English that will be easily understandable by others. That is more than enough for you, right? He is adding here that if a person who moved to England, if he tries to speak a very good way of speaking English, then everyone will start suspecting him, right? No one will understand what he wants to say. And rather than they will start suspecting. Here he is giving one example. If you say, "Will you have the goodness, sir, to direct me to the railway terminus at Charing Cross?" Pronouncing all the vowels and consonants beautifully. See how beautiful the sentence have been given. How beautifully he is asking for the address, right? But he will not understand you because you are very formal here. You are speaking very good way of English and will suspect you of being a beggar or a confidence trickster. He will think that you are a trickster definitely. But if you shout, "Please, Charing Cross, which way?" Right? So that is just an informal way of asking the route, right? That is correct, right? That is the same thing that you have asked very formally before. Just see the difference between the first and the second sentence. The first sentence is, "Will you have the goodness, sir, to direct me to the railway terminus at Charing Cross?" Right? See the length of the sentence. That is too lengthy. No one will have time to listen to you. Just for showing the address, you have to be short and precise but clear, right? But in the second sentence, you are very good. Like, "Please, Charing Cross, which way?" The points that have to be mentioned are picturized very beautifully, are asked very beautifully. Then the listener will have attention towards you. You will have no difficulty. Half a dozen people will immediately overwhelm you with directions. So more than half a dozen people will be ready to show you the directions. Even in private intercourse with cultivated people, you must not speak too well. Apply this to your attempts to learn foreign languages and never try to speak them too well. And do not be afraid to travel. So here what he is saying, don't try to be perfect. Right? Just be friendly and informal little bit. Don't, in your personal life also, don't try to talk to others in a very good way, very formal way, right? Just try to speak well, but not too well. And never afraid to travel, right? You will be surprised to find how little you need to know or how badly you may pronounce. Even among English people, to speak too well is a pedantic affectation. In a foreigner, it is something worse than affectation. It is an insult to the native who cannot understand his own language when it is too well spoken. That is all I can tell you. The record will hold no more. Goodbye. So what he is saying, just travel as much as you can, because then only you will come to know that how little it is to, how easy it is to learn any language, right? Don't try to be very perfect, because if you go to a foreign country and speak a very good English, right? If you go and stand in front of an Englishman and you just pronounce the words that are not even understandable by him, then it will be a great insult for him only. So better you speak the language in a very simple and understandable way. Don't try to act as an oversmart fellow who is trying to learn the language more good than a native speaker, right? If the language is understandable, that is more than enough. So that is what about our lesson, right? In which George Bernard Shaw is beautifully picturizing, right, how a person can learn a foreign language very easily in a simple way. You need not get panic for that, right? Just try to learn any language in a very simple and easy and understandable way. I hope you all have enjoyed the lesson. Let us continue in our next class. Thank you.